Okay. Good morning, everyone online. We're glad to have you with us this morning. We hope you have a good day today. The sun's going to shine, I think, and maybe not rain. So enjoy the service with us this morning. This on Wednesday, we will have our 6:30 prayer time. And on Thursday, June the 3rd, at 7, we'll have church chat. And are there any other announcements that we haven't made? Okay, then, yes?
The Kesher Bible School will have our first day on Wednesday afternoon from 1 to 3. Our kids' camp, we're calling it. And so bring your children, grandchildren, and your neighbor's children.
Wednesday afternoon, we need to gang up on all the kids in town and have them come to kids' camp. Okay, that's Wednesday.
Yes.
1 to 3. That'll be a fun time. Yes, Gail. Okay. Okay. Now we will stand and sing our opening song, Trust and Obey.
Where all the Come to you today because we realize we have no place else to go to find the hope and the strength that we need. We know you're the God of all comfort, and we just ask your comfort upon the families that have been mentioned today who've lost loved ones. Lord, we know it's a grievous time when we lose someone that's been near and dear to us. But Father, we thank you for the hope we have in Jesus Christ, that hope that extends far beyond this world into something far better. Father, we want to pray right now for our upcoming vacation Bible school. Lord, I just pray that you would bring to us young people who would have eager ears and open hearts to hear your word, and that we might be able to plant seeds in their life that would grow and make a difference in the future. Father, we pray for the workers that you give them strength and wisdom as well. And Lord, we thank you for this special weekend. We remember those who served our country, those who fought and died, that we might have freedom. And Lord, we're grateful for their sacrifice and what they've done for us. But Father, most of all, we thank you for the freedom we enjoy in Jesus Christ. We thank you that he was willing to die for us so we might be free from sin. And Lord, may we realize that freedom is never free. And may we have that hope in him. May at all times we trust him. May we walk with him. And today we pray that your word would speak to our hearts and lives, that Lord, that your spirit would be moving in our midst, that we would know that God is here. And your word is touching us. And now, Father, we pray that you would help us to pray as your son taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
You may be seated. We're doing a series looking at the prophet Elijah, and we looked the first week at the times in which Elijah lived. They were very troubled times. They were times of where evil seemed to be triumphing over the land. We looked last week at the power of God that was evident in the life of the prophet Elijah. Today we're going to look at Elijah learning to trust God. It's a lesson all of us need to learn, that God is a God we can trust, a God who's going to be there for us. So we look at Elijah. Look at 1 Kings chapter 17, beginning in verse 1. Now Elisha the Tishbite from Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord the God of Israel lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years except at my word." Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, "Leave here, turn eastward, and hide in the Kereth ravine east of the Jordan. You will drink from the brook, and I have directed the ravens to supply you with food there." So he did what the Lord told him, and he went to the Kereth ravine east of the Jordan and stayed there. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. So Elijah delivered a word from God to the king. Now God has a word for Elijah. Get out of town and get out quick. God is sending Elijah into hiding. God is putting Elijah in his witness protection program. God is hiding Elijah while Queen Jezebel is throwing her temper tantrum. Elijah is staying hidden while the effects of the drought are being felt, and while he's waiting for God to make his next move. God, in the meantime, is keeping his spokesman safe. He's hiding him. God has prepared for Elisha a room in the resort of the prophets. I'm not sure it's a resort you'd really want to go to. God told him to go and hide in a ravine, a desolate ravine at that. Kereth is a deep wadi that winds its way through the wilderness. It's on the east side of the Jordan, and Kereth means drought. I find it rather ironic that the prophet prophesies there's going to be a drought, and then God sends him to a place called drought. Suddenly, we see Elijah appearing on the national scene and speaking to the king. And just as soon as he had done that, God takes him off that stage, and God hides him from Jezebel's searching assassins. So in the wilderness, in the ravine, Elijah's alone. Well, almost alone. God is there. Wilderness is a place where God has called Elijah, that God might prepare Elijah for the next work he has planned for him to do. The wilderness is an alone place. It's the best place to get to know God. The wilderness becomes Elijah's place for a quiet retreat with just him and God. The wilderness is not just a quiet place, it's a place of solitude. It's a place to gain new and deeper understanding of God. It's a place to experience the presence of God. It's a place to get to know God in a fresh and new way. Now, if you go to Christian bookstores, you'll find there's been several books written on spiritual disciplines. Probably the classic work is that by Richard Foster on Celebration of Disciplines. Now, every list includes certain ones, prayer, Bible study, and fasting, and then there's a few others that some include and some don't. But in Foster's, he has one called solitude. Most of them do not include it. And we live in a very busy society. In fact, our society is noisy and busy, and in that chapter on solitude in my book, I had written these words: "Our society has become so busy and so stressful and so noisy that one can't even sleep in church." And that's bad. Foster writes, "Our fear of being alone drives us to the noise and the crowds. We keep a constant stream of words, even if they are inane." Jean Fleming writes, "We live in a noisy, busy world. Silence and solitude are not 20th century virtues in a noisy, busy world. Silence and solitude are not 20th century words. They fit an era of Victorian lace and high button shoes and kerosene lamps better than an age of television, video arcades, and joggers wired with earphones. We've become a people with an aversion to quiet. We're uneasy with being alone. You see, the conditions of our Western culture make us comfortable with noise and crowd, but it does not make us comfortable with silence and solitude. Foster further explains that, noise versus clatter are not the only two alternatives out there. He says we can cultivate a inner solitude and silence that sets us free from loneliness and fear. I like the way he defines this. He says loneliness is an inner emptiness. You're alone, you're empty. But he says solitude is an inner fulfillment. We know there's something on the inside. Solitude is more a state of a mind and a state of heart than it is a place. Now, the wilderness is a place of solitude. It's a time to reflect upon God. It's a time to hear God. But the wilderness is not only a place to hear God, it's a place to learn to trust God, to get to know Him in a deep and profound way. Solitude sets us free from the things that would otherwise drive us, our fears, our ego, our pride, our securities, even other people. Solitude helps us to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. Solitude helps us to gain clarity of purpose. Now, did you notice that Elijah had room service? I mean, the ravens brought him bread and meat every morning and every evening. Would you like to have waiters like that? Now, ravens like to eat. In fact, from the word raven, we get the word ravenous. And I can't help but think God had to be in this, otherwise it would eat that food before it got to the prophet. But at Kirith, one learns a dependency upon God. We learn to trust in God. We learn to keep our hearts focused on God. God is caring for Elijah physically, but more importantly is what God is doing for him spiritually. Now, there was not an abundance of water out there in that creek. And then there's this drought, and the creek dries up. You see, the drought has affected not only the Baal worshipers, it's affected the man of God who predicted it. Now, God brought Elijah to this dry and desolate place. But God never forgot him. God may lead you to an abandoned place, but God will never abandon you. So in verse 7, it says, sometime later the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. And the word of the Lord came to him at once, to go at once to Zarephath, to a region in Zidon, and stay there. He said, I've directed a widow to supply you with food. The word of the Lord came to him. He says, go to Zarephath. Zarephath. God, you got to be kidding. It's 80 miles to Zarephath, and I'm on foot. God, Zarephath is a long ways from Samaria, where the action's at, where King Ahab hangs out. God, aren't there some widows in Israel I can go to? God, don't you know that Zarephath is only 8 miles down the coast from Tyre, and that's the center of Baal worship? That's not a good place to hide. And God, I don't even know how to spell Zarephath. But God sends him to Zarephath anyway. So in verse 10, when he went to Zarephath, he came to a town gate, and a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? Well, that's nice of him. Nice of her. She was going to get it, and he called, bring me, please, a piece of bread. As surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread. only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. So Elijah arrives. He's hungry. He's weary from the travel. He's lonely. It's been months since he's had an intelligent conversation with anybody but the birds and the animals. And to make matters worse, he's now in the shadow of the center of Baal worship. He's living in the what we would call the Baal Belt. And this is not exactly a safe place for the prophet of God. But nobody has ever said doing God's will is going to be safe and secure, that there would be no risks. There's always an element of vulnerability when you do God's will. Now, what would you have done if you had been in Elijah's sandals? You've had a long hike. It's hot and dry. You're tired, you're thirsty, you're hungry. And you ask this widow for food. You were hoping for a rich widow. Instead, she has no food in the house. She's getting ready to take what little flour and oil she has left and cook her funeral dinner. God, you made a mistake. You sent me the wrong person. God, is this some kind of a bad joke? You see, God sent Elijah to Zarephath to someone who was going to provide for him, and Elijah finds that he's staring hopeless poverty and certain death in the face. So in verse 13, Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid." You got to be kidding. "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, 'The jar of flour will not be used up and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land.'" Again, God does not send him to some flashy, fancy resort with lots of comforts and convenience at his disposal. He sends him to a widow who can no longer care for herself. Her world's falling apart. Your heart has to go out to her. She's lost her husband. She has a young son to care for, and she has no resources. This is her day of despair. She's headed to certain death. Fate says she's finished. I believe God sent Elijah to Zarephath, not just for Elijah's benefit, but for the benefit of this widow as well. You see, God seldom sends us anywhere for our own benefit. Whenever God sends us someplace, he expects us to meet some people along the way and help some people along the way. God has his work for us along the way. It's never just about us. So Elijah asks for some bread and water. And the widow begins with these words, "As surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives." Now, I don't know about you, but that statement amazes me. Was she a believer in Yahweh? Did she know about Elijah's God? Did this woman, this Canaanite woman who lived in the very shadow of the center of pagan Baal worship, did she know the true God? And you can't read these words without emotion. "Surely, I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour and water, and I'm going to gather some sticks for a meal, and we're going to eat, and we're going to die." Your heart has to go out to her. It's a statement of fact. It sounds fatalistic. She's resigned the fact she's going to die. This is the end. There's no options. And Elijah says, "Don't be afraid. You got to be kidding." She's about to starve to death, and this stranger, this foreigner, says, "Don't be afraid." And he says, "Go home and make some bread." Well, that's what she was planning on doing. That's what she'd already told him. But there's one little caveat. He says, "Bake some bread for me first." And she's thinking, do you want me and my son to starve to death immediately? If you were in her shoes, how would you have responded to the prophet that day? "But first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me, and then make some for yourself and your son." That is a big ask. Talk about audacity. "You take care of me first," the prophet concludes. This is what the Lord says. "The oil and the flour will not be used up, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth, land. Now, we've been talking about Elijah living by faith. But I don't know about you, but I think the greater lesson here is this widow living by faith. I think it takes far more faith to do what she's been asked to do than what Elijah's been asked to do. Take what you have left and give it to God's prophet first. Now let me ask you, do you have that kind of faith? Do you put God first and then expect Him to take care of your needs? When God says, put me first in your finances and I'll provide, put me first in your time, you see, she did and He did. I heard a story once of a man who was really down on his luck. I mean, he was broke. He was down to his last $20, and he was this Christian gathering of some kind, and they were taking up an offering, and he gave his last $20. And later, God blessed him, and he got back on his feet. In fact, he became a millionaire, and he began doing seminars on how he gave his last $20 to God, and God made him a millionaire. And in one of his seminars, this little lady raised her hand. She said, would you do it again? You know, sometimes it's easier to trust God when you're down on your luck and you don't have any place else to turn than when we have a lot of our own resources to protect. You see, our job is to obey and leave the consequences to God. Notice verse 15. She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the widow, and or the woman, her family. For the jar of flour was not used up and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word the Lord had spoken by Elijah. Now I think there's some lessons that you and I need to learn in the midst of all of this. The first lesson is simply this. God keeps His word. God always provides. Sometimes God wants us to trust Him with what little resources we have. You see, if we're not going to trust God with little things, how do we expect God to trust us with big things? There'll be times when it seems like the resources that we have are going to run dry. But may I remind you that God's resources never run dry. Secondly, we need to learn that in the tough times are faith-building times. God goes to some rather lengthy measures to teach us to trust Him. He wants us to build faith in Him. God wants us to fully rely on Him. Years ago, the kids were learning about frog. It has to do with faith. It means fully relying on God. Now, I think that's a great definition of faith. You can remember that frog, fully relying on God. God may be using the desert time to prepare us for something really big for Him. In the midst of our dry times, we need to remember that God is often preparing our character before He can use us. God wants to prepare us and work in us before He can work through us. Thirdly, God generally leads us one step at a time. So we just need to take one step at a time. The future belongs to God. Only He knows the future. What will happen next is God's business. Leave it to Him. We need to do His will today. Let tomorrow take care of itself. We don't understand God's playbook. We don't know what lesson is on the next page of God's lessons book. We only see the present. We only see what's before us. So we need to make sure that we learn the lesson that God has for us today. Fourthly, God is never late, but seldom early. Learn to trust Him. Learn to wait on God. Now, we want to do things according to our timetable, right? God, I want it, and I want it now. And God, I want it my way now. We need to learn to work according to His timetable. God knows what is best for us. And finally, God, number five, God is a God of constant surprises. God often uses some very unconventional methods. Don't try to put God in a box. I mean, I don't know about you, but sending Him down to a wadi with a little brook down there and feeding Him with ravens was not exactly a conventional method. Sending Him to Zarephath was not a conventional method. Okay? Don't put God in a box. He has wondrous ways of performing for us. God provides for us, and oftentimes in a way we did not expect, and certainly not in a way we had hoped for. So don't spend a lot of time trying to figure God out. Just trust Him. Several years ago, you may remember Isaac Newton wrote the book, the song Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound That Saved a Wretch Like Me. Along about the same time was another man, William Cowper. And in 1773, he penned these words: God moves in a mysterious way His wonders to perform. He plants His footsteps in the sea and rides upon the storm. You and I have learned to trust God. Regardless what's going on out there, regardless what is our circumstances, we have to realize we have no place else to turn but to God. He'll never let us down. He'll never fail us. Just trust Him. If you've never trusted Him and given your life to Him, we're going to sing an invitation hymn. We invite you to come. Have thine own way. Shall we stand as we sing? That was a short song.
As we honor Memorial Day and celebrate Memorial Day tomorrow, I want to read a verse from John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. Freedom is a gift. It's a treasure. And though we all may agree on that truth, it's often easy to take for granted the greatest gifts that God has given us in our lives. But those most precious gifts are never free. They came with a price, with a sacrifice. They were worth fighting for, and are still worth fighting for today. Many brave men and women were willing to face hard battles in order for us to enjoy that gift of freedom today. And for all those who have protected our nation, for the men and women in uniform, together we say thank you. As we prepare for communion, let us remember today and say a prayer of gratefulness for the many who have been willing to pay a great price for our freedom. May God help us to live so courageously. May we follow the brave examples of those who have gone before us. And thank you for reminding us that there's incredible love and sacrifice displayed when one is willing to stand strong and fight for freedom. This service of love and sacrifice on behalf of all people points us directly to the greatest love of all, the very gift and sacrifice of Christ. Our Savior was willing to pay the ultimate price so that we can live free forever. May we pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the freedom you have given to us and for the price that was paid by Christ so that we could live free. We remember today the cost of it all, the great sacrifice for freedom. We ask this in your holy name. Amen. We want to thank everyone for coming today to worship with us, and we'll sing Rooftops as we're released and rose by the diaconate and to partake in communion in the back. And please drop your offerings and blessing quarters in the trays by the doorway. And please wait to visit with one another until you go outside. Yes?
You can stay inside and we're going to have bread, and it might even have a little bit in.
Okay. Did everybody hear that? We can stay inside instead of going outside. In the parlor. Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Brings me to my knees to share.